Oh, are we actually going to see Catherine now? It says Catherine. Boss? Matthew?
Hey, Ma.
Right on, you Muppet. You've been gone for so long that you don't even recall what we mad bunnies used to look like. Mad bunnies? You've known that vagrant for long? Why haven't you told me so? Well, I hardly imagine you'd be interested in hearing about every little friend I made back when we were or just another gang rolling in the sweaty, muddy streets. Boss, why are you working with this blighter? Wait, no, but that bass, those rabbit ears. Wait, you're still with the dead rabbits? Yeah, we've, changed a tad, eh? Remember, lad, back in the day when we had... All we needed was to crack some Adam's family heads. With some tattered scarf round our necks and bottles of beer on tap. They're actually referencing Adam's family? We've even named one of them beers after you, didn't we? The pub that used to sell that beer closed shop a few weeks ago. Ain't much business around with the dreadful rumor keeping everyone home nowadays.
What?
The
wolf folk
closed? Bloody hell. Oh, then I suppose I'm leaving y'all out of the loop, eh? Well, allow me to introduce the gaffer. He was the boss of the old syndicate I used to run with. They're all friends of yours, eh? Joined some posh, proper company after running down on us out of nowhere, did you? Well, things just worked out that way. Are all them lads and lasses your lackeys? Blimey, got a walking timepiece with you too, you daft bastard. You've clearly moved up in the world, eh? Heh. Heathcliff, you want to...
What?
Lackeys? Ishmael glared at Heathcliff with a look that could kill, but she decided to hold her silence and merely shook her head in disbelief. She probably decided that it was not worth the trouble. So, what's with the mask, boss?
What?
Is it up? Trends change with time, lad. Time for scarves with rabbits embroidered is long past. Is that so? It looks a bit... Of course not. Who do you think we are? We the dead rabbits ain't a bookish rabble that follows the coattails of some naff trend. You really not once returned to this place since you left, have you? No. When I left this manor, and eventually the dead rabbits, I made a promise to myself that I'd not return. Not even a step closer to this place until I made something of myself. Not until I can return as a successful man. Well, you've always hated this place, even when you were one of us. I've got news for you, Heathcliff. We're no longer the same lowly backstreet gang you're familiar with. I suppose we've also moved up in the world. Someone from the ring who's been keeping their eyes on us plucked us right off the streets and into their fold. We're bigger now. We're one of the up-and-coming syndicates. The ring? One of the fingers? Must be the fastest of the ring, then. They're the only ones whose outfit at their underlings with these cheap, tasky animal masks. Then you're... Yeah, you little shite. I'm the top boss of the dead rabbits now. Boss. Remember what you always used to say when we've each filled up with more than three bottles of beer? What we drank when we were some lousy beer made from halfway rotten wheat, Heathcliff? Halfway rotten wheat. All that I remembered coming the next morn was a pounding headache and a light feeling of our emptied pockets. You used to tell me that it hurt like hell every time one of your own men came back to us hurt. even the recruits. Like, they hurt not just as an underling, but an extension of you. I knew you'd make it big one day, boss. Well, I suppose drunk me knew how to wax poetic. I knew it was you, Matthew. The mask threw me off for a moment, boss. What a sorry sight this is. I sincerely apologize to you two sweethearts for crashing your tearful reunion. But the point is, while you were wandering the streets, wasting away the best years of your life on the road, Mess made something of himself. Which is why I hired him as my bodyguard, you heard me? You hear me? Not like you and your merry band of no-name second-rate hooligans. I could think of no more than a few sinners who would have gotten angry enough to brandish their weapons at such an insult. I could think of more than a few. Okay. Off the top of my head, Ryoshu, he was usually one of them. Don, maybe, depending on how slighted she feels at the insult. Roja, possibly. Gregor, probably a little bit. Ishmael, for sure. Oh, I think like Faust and Sinclair might be the only ones. Maybe not Meru. Like Faust, Sinclair, Meru. Jisung, probably. Like, those are the four I would think least likely. But they all seem to remember that responding to such insults with violence only beget pointless turmoil, so instead they began sighing heavily in an attempt to vent some of their pent-up anger. Henley, you seem to be sorely mistaken. This isn't the same winter you... In the same winter, you thrashed me, treated me like an indentured servant, and abused me like a hound. I won't deny that I spent many days and nights imagining tearing that foul tongue from your gob. But he threw a glance briefly in our direction. Even a poor sod like myself found a place to belong, went on adventures to places you couldn't even imagine, learned a thing or two from them. So I just feel bad for you, mate. What? Because you really haven't changed one bit. Besides, the hell is that rag you're wearing? You're more like a drifting vagabond than I... You look more like a drifting vagabond than I do. What? You insolent fool. The man's been saying some pretty nasty stuff about us. But he doesn't even look like someone that's been worth arguing. That he's someone worth arguing with. Ah, mate. Did you even check yourself in the mirror in the last week? I can't bear to look at you so down in the dumps, Henley. Of course, we had no way of knowing what Henley looked like in the past, but we could pretty easily tell that he was far from the most stable person in the room. You fucking bastard. Now, Mr. Henley, why don't you seat yourself up on the sofa and calm down? Be more considerate of our boys standing in that corner watching the whole thing go down, huh? They don't even get at these comfy looking leather sofas. Henley grumbled for a moment before slumping down on a sofa, and even that simple action was stumbling and pathetic. I see what happened. He let the alcohol consume him, and not the other way around. Fell into a big, nasty barrel with no way out. I've seen the same look on some sailors, failing to pull themselves out of the habit. Would lead them straight into merciless maws of the lake, not even a trace of them would be left. Well, this man's still my client. Mr. Henley hired me for some job, which is why I'm here at Wuthering Heights. Job. Catherine's hosting this banquet, ain't she? What kind of job could possibly need the dead rabbits help here? What? Huh? A banquet? Well, I suppose there's one thing that hasn't changed with time. It's that witless, useless brain of yours, you feckless dullard. Henley. Please cease this at once, I implore you. I do not wish to see my manner sullied with such foul obscenities. This is not your home, Linton. It's mine. It's my manor. You're the one who sold this noble Northern Heights, my birthright, bestowed upon me by my father, by taking it from me by the means of trickery. Was it your own family, only two, too small for you, Linton Egger? Your oh-so-noble Edgar family? Edgar family? The time for whining, crying, and throwing a tantrum to get what you want is long past. Bold words from a milksop who's about to choke himself to death on air. Please maintain your distance, Mr. Henley. I see in mongrels more lowly than you lot. I was your master only a few years ago. Have you cast aside your memories as well as you did your loyalty? Cease this at once, Master Henley. The butlers have all left Henley and the Earnshaw behind, as you are well aware. Or yourself. And you too, butlers. We do not want to make further trouble here. Understood, Chief Butler Nelly. After a brief silence, Heathcliff finally brought up the question he'd been stewing for so long. Nelly, where is Catherine? I want to check something. Because there is something about Linton that's kind of interesting to me. Because, okay, Linton is her husband. The fact that he seems coughing and sick feels like an overlap. Like, definitely the children aren't around. It seems fairly obvious, and I assumed as much from where this kind of places. If any child is around, it might be Henley's, but I doubt that will be brought up at all. But shit. Who was Heathcliff's son's name? Heathcliff's son. Oh, no wonder I also get so fucking confused. Wuthering Heights characters. Hareton Earnshaw is Henley's son, so he might show up. And then there's Linton Heathcliff. So Linton Heathcliff's son is kind of sickly. Like, he's in poor health for almost seemingly all of his life. And I'm wondering if they're over, since they aren't inducing their children, the fact that, Catherine's husband, Linton, is coughing, I'm wondering if they kind of merged the son's sickliness into Linton Eggers' character for Limbus side, because that's what it's seeming to be with him coughing and whatnot.
알잖아, 캐서린은
yet to see the sister.
시끄러운 걸 못 견뎌했어.
You must know, Nelly, that Catherine never did like these commotions. So many guests making so much noise in her home, she won't be pleased.
그랬지.
I suppose she never did. I've been keeping my volume in check because I didn't want to offend her, but it's getting harder and harder to keep it down. There was a look of unfathomable, immeasurable grief on both Linton and Nelly. Did Catherine kill herself? Henley was absentmindedly mumbling some foul language at the ceiling, and Heathcliff probably sensed from the ineffable dark and ominous silence that something was terribly wrong. Or something with the golden ball has caused her to be incapacitated in some way. It was setting in for us as well. After all we've been through in this journey, this kind of silence was all too familiar.
Where's Catherine?
What is this dour look on everyone? I'm Terry Sarlet, early Heathcliff. What the hell are you sorry about?
Heathcliff.
Heathcliff. I may have a correct assumption as to what this silence indicates. So I have no other choice but to tell you, as it is common courtesy to do so, that I am very sorry to hear that. What the fuck? Can you talk normally for once? I hardly know how to tell you this, but Miss Catherine isn't here anymore. What do you mean she's not? Catherine, she's
죽었다.
Dead. I have no love lost. Feel bad for Heath. But I am still thinking something with the golden ball is gonna make her be alive in some fashion. Potentially. Cause she feels like a better final boss than Linton or Henley would be. Linton looked up at Heathcliff, his eyes were bloodshot. As you said earlier, none of us are here to see each other's ugly mugs. What other reason could we possibly have to reconvene like this? That can't be real. What kind of insane? Now, fixers of the Ufi Association, who had remained silent throughout the entire commotion, suddenly spoke up. The promised hour is Mr. Henley Earnshaw, a blood relative of the deceased. Mr. Linton Edgar, the spouse of the deceased. And Mr. Heathcliff, an individual mentioned by name in the will. Oh, wow, she might actually be dead. Oh, come on, I wanted to fight her. Now I'm a little disappointed. Damn. Now the three relevant parties are all present. We, as the executors of the deceased's will, may begin the ceremony. The first order of business will be the execution. Execution made my brain like short circuit for a second of Miss Catherine's will. That seems such a weird wording. Thus commences the solemn occasion, Miss Catherine's funeral rites. As per deceased wishes, the will shall be read aloud here at Miss Catherine's manor, in attendance of all those present. Then, no. You? Stop. Shut up for a second. Whose funeral rites? And what was that about her spouse? The man they called Linton rose from a seat for the first time since we arrived here. After you abandoned this place with nary a word to her, Catherine immediately turned to me. Then we married. Every waking hour we spent together were filled with happiness and joy. We were happy to the very last day, to her very last breath. Shut your stupid gob. The moment I set my foot in this manor, I heard her voice. I felt her presence. So what the bloody hell are you even talking about? This has to be some ploy. These fucking bastards, they must have... This can't. Heathcliff paused for a moment, struggling to find the words. This can't be how it ends. I won't believe a single shite coming out of your mouth until I see her body with my own eyes. Where is she? Bring her here now. What a repulsive sight. The least you could have done was to show some proper respect for the dead. But I suppose even the bare minimum was too much to expect from someone like... I understand how you feel, Heathcliff, so please calm yourself and take a seat. Get your hands off me. You can't just decide for me that she's dead. I won't accept any of this, not until I see Kathy with my own
경고합니다.
Warning. Should this interruption of the will reading continue, we will have to resort to use of force to ensure the full execution of this will. Shut up! You don't know shite, so shut your fucking mouth. Heathcliff was gasping. The sheer momentous of emotion overwhelmed him. It looked as though he was about to lunge at anyone who even dared to get close. I could hardly tell whether it was sorrow or wrath that came over him. Heathcliff, why don't you go look in the mirror yourself? What a pathetic mess you've become. Doesn't matter what posh god pleb like you wrap yourself in, that filth of yours ill from your low birth seeps right through the fabric at the slightest provocation. You'll eventually see Catherine Scorpio's, all right? It's all part of the funeral process, so don't be in such a hurry to get there. I can't wait to see how well she's resting after what she's done to me. Mr. Hindley Earnshaw, Mr. Heathcliff, we ordered that both of you immediately return to your seats. This is your final warning. Mr. Manager Esquire, we must do all to none. This is something Oofy may even execute those was involved should there be a breach of contract. I ill wish to see Sir Heathcliff to be executed, nor do I wish to have to battle the honorable fixers of the Oofy Association. I agree with Don Quixote, there is no need for us to get involved in an unnecessary conflict, but I don't think Heathcliff's going to listen to us. I don't even know if there's anyone who can talk to Heathcliff down from who can talk Heathcliff down when he's that agitated. You have refused to comply. We had no choice but to watch as the fixers of the Oofy Association struck Heathcliff with their weapons. He fell to his knees with a painful cry. Yes. Do speak. Not you, Yi-sung. Speak still, your intention notwithstanding. You stop, all of you. Something's off about this whole thing. Would you like to speak for this individual? was what she was going to say, but she decided to remain silent in favor of not getting in trouble. Right? Huh? What are you doing, Bug guy? I know that one. Yoshu. I understand that seeing our fellow sinner get smacked around like that can be pretty aggravating, but once you get involved, peace will simply no longer be an option. Didn't know you care so much about Heathcliff, Ryoshu. I'm assuming not care or no care. Ryoshu flicked her cigarette indifferently as though she was no longer interested. Oh, no comment. NC. You bastards. Fine, let's crack some skulls then, shall we? Heathcliff stumbled to his feet with a club in his hand, glaring at everyone that stood before him. I see that you are still refusing to comply despite our initial attempt. Should you refuse to let go of your weapon within the next minute, we will have no choice but to escalate to our next steps. I couldn't care less about your steps. Give me Catherine or none of us are leaving this manor alive. You lot, me, we're all going 6 feet under. Heathcliff! Shut it, Clockhead! This ain't time to bring up shite like the company rules. Stay out of my way. I don't have anything to say. If someone that important to me died, I'd be blinded and deafened to all reason, too. Hey, Heath. I understand how angry and frustrated you must be, but you can't. Shut your trap, all of you. Don't you dare touch me unless you want your faces caved in too. It's nap time, Heathcliff.
Oh.
Did she just knock him out cold with her bare hands? And it wasn't even a punch. It was just a light tap. His breathing is stable. It appears that she gave the nerve on the back of his head a precise focus strike, which led to his loss of consciousness. What a flawless execution of that move. I can certainly say that I've seen something like that before. Reminds me of my family's. Sir Heathcliff have been defeated with a single fell strike? Every self-respecting butler has to be equipped with one such move. What other choice have we got when the child fusses and fusses for 20 hours instead of going to sleep? With quite confidence that I can immediately slumber to the dreamlands upon untucking myself in bed. For truth. Though it is not by his own volition, we have confirmed that he is no longer in possession of a weapon and has been subdued. We will allow for a 10-minute recess to let things calm down for a moment, and then we will proceed as planned. Excuse me, Lady Nelly? Lady Nelly, no need for such honorifics. Please just call me Nelly. The contractors that Mr. Linton Edgar brought, they once worked at this manor, right? Yes, indeed. Some butlers from the Earnshaws, like myself, followed Miss Catherine to Master Linton's. Of course, most of Master Linton's butlers are from his own Edgar family. So, if he gives the order to attack us, Lady Nelly would... Oh, pish-posh. Ridiculous. I was a butler in direct service of Miss Catherine. Young Mr. Linton could plead and beg only once, but I won't always be taking his side. What exactly are the butlers? Butlers? Forsooth, I am quite well acquainted with this matter. They are house dogs on tight leash, groveling before their masters. The most trustworthy and loyal people I've ever known, I'd say. Fixers bound to families. Ooh. So the butlers are also, like, in a way, their own association, but they're not necessarily grouped by... Huh. House dogs on a tight leash groveling before their masters. Okay, so Ryoshu absolutely has connection to them. And I can see, this is giving me ideas for where her book has some things. Which, her comment is very interesting. And then Hong Lu has a very different relationship with them because he's more in the position of, say, Catherine into Nelly, or even Henley to his servants, or Linton to his butlers, of he's in that position of he is part of the masters, that where Ryoshu witnessed witness butlers basically be on the leash to a master. Nice. Gotcha. Some great help you fellows are. Honestly, I found it helpful, Gregor. Well, I'm glad that I'm not the only one out of the loop for once. I understood it, Dante. At least some of you know who we butlers are. It is a rather rare occupation. Not many people even know that we exist. Doesn't sound like most normal folk would have a reason to know anything about them. Unless they're in a position where they have no choice but to work at a rich folk's home. Well, one of us is quite a passionate fan of fixers. Quite. Oh, I'm very pleased to know that our dear Heathcliff made some very intelligent friends. Lady Nelly, I promise thee that once I make my return to the bus, I shall have my hands on the butler figurine I had given up on acquiring. It shall stand tall and proud out on the frontmost row of my display shelf. Don Quixote's eyes were practically exploding with joy at having her fixer obsession positively acknowledged and accepted for once. Allow me to explain. Butlers are fixers indeed, yet they are rather distinct from most fixers thou hast encountered thus far. A fixer oft refer to those who accept contracts as part of an association or an office. Alas, there exists this distinction when it comes to butlers. Butlers join families or manors to serve them, and only them. On long-term contracts, forsooth, like any other fixer, butlers may be hired by a single person to serve them and only them as well. Do note that our service is not limited to combat. We also conduct household management and care as well. It must also be mentioned that the proficiency in many fields is a necessity to be a respected butler. This is no easy occupation, mind you. Yet, from what I've learned, to hire a butler is to pay an inordinate amount of salary. Indeed, while butlers are always oh so busy, we are promised expensive compensation, as every contract extension with stable bonuses such as pensions. Many famous association fixers also retired to serve as butlers as well. I was once a butler in service of Miss Catherine's family and was transferred to Master Linton and Anchor's family to join their ranks when she married him. Still, after a rather peaceful mutual debate, we came to the conclusion that I will be assuming the position of the chief butler, leader of the butlers in that household. Gotcha. Totally peaceful. I'm sure it really was one peaceful transfer of power. Oh, 'tis quite fascinating to imagine that Sir Heathcliff once had been a tiny Byron? Once had been a tiny Baron. How was he as a youth? He was quite the special child. I do not believe... Oh, crap. I hit too fast. He was quite the special child. I do not believe that I would have become a chief butler had it not been for him. Oh, what a lovely boy he was. Lovely. Quite. I don't think people believe you, Nelly. At least not the sinners. At least not Don Quixote. Wow, these are like compact together. The ghost? Catherine's haunting this place. I'm calling it. She's showing up. If she doesn't show up, I'm actually gonna be a little upset. You name a chapter after her and she's dead the entire time? Excuse me? Well, name a season after her even, actually. Are you okay, Heathcliff? It's that classic Nelly technique, hey? Her secret technique to send us hurling into the dreamlands. Been a while. I am terribly sorry, Heathcliff. I was hoping to avoid having to use that sleepy smack on you. And not after a reunion like this. Is it true, Nelly? Is Catherine really gone? Yes. And Miss Catherine wrote your name into her will. Her will, huh? We should at least give it a listen to hear why she mentioned Heathcliff. Heathcliff sat down wordlessly. So was this matter Miss Catherine's? Well, it used to be young Master Henley's once, then Catherine, not true. She snapped me in the back. Why don't you elaborate on that injustice, Linton? Share the tale of how Catherine and Linton Egger stabbed me in the back. How the pair of you destroyed me. There was no injustice. It was done in part in a perfectly legal manner. Bring the case to T-Corp, of course, if you wish. It will change absolutely nothing. A doofy association fixer carrying a piece of paper stepped in between Henley and Linton as two men and continued to growl each other. The allotted recess has expired. We will now proceed the inheritance bequeathment and will reading. This is the will of the deceased. It has been verified via multiple tests and screenings that no counterfeiting or tampering of a similar nature has occurred. If they're verifying it, if it's a counterfeit or not, who verifies if they're not just straight up lying about it? Good question. Maybe it's just a standard industry practice. Miss Catherine has requested that this letter be read in an audience of the three attendees before the equipment of personal property commences. I will now read the full contents of her will. At last, you are all gathered here. My only wish is that my words will be met with respect without hostility among you. I hope that none of you become incensed during this occasion. It is my one and only funeral, after all. I am at peace. There is no pain, no suffering where I am. So do not consider my death a tragic one. Because by the time you are hearing this, I must have reached my own heaven. This is not to say that you mustn't let sorrow grow into your heart. Weep if you will, so that I may feel your grief and know that you have all truly loved me. Wuthering Heights, an old desolate manor. I have always been afraid of this place. Fear and nightmares would consume me every night. But now that I stand before the end of my life, I have come to accept this manor for what it is. This manor, which I will leave to my husband, Linton Egger. Keep this manor and remember me by its presence. What the fuck? Damn it. And my brother Henley, my one and only brother. Right! I knew I'd be in there somewhere. Henley's legs began to shake nervously, so did his voice. I heard that you are mired in quite the heavy debt, and that you've been spending most of your days drinking and gambling. So I... Come on, Catherine. Give me something. Anything. Signed you up for an Abyss Trauma Correctional Facility at M-Corp. If you don't visit the facility within 1 week after attending this will reading, they will come to take you in. What? I truly hope that your heart will be healed, dear brother. No, that's absolute nonsense. How am I supposed to get to M-Corp in a week? Of course, I've already prepared a warp train ticket to M-Corp for you. So please don't worry about the travel fees. No, this is a load of shite. Should another instance of disturbance to the execution of this will occur, we will take forcible actions without warning. Yeah, Henley, you might want to shut up, because I could bring back Heathcliff, but you're gonna be SOL. How dare you, plebs. And you, Heathcliff. Welcome home. Kathy, I'm... Once the seventh strike of lightning falls upon this manor, My golden ball shall be yours. Huh? The mere mention of the golden ball suddenly intensified the sensation I felt earlier. I definitely sensed the golden ball was located somewhere within this manor. But I already figured that the golden ball was somewhere in here. I've known that ever since we stepped foot into this manor. Yet I couldn't quite pinpoint its exact location because I will leave my golden ball to you, Heathcliff. The golden ball was her personal property? Not even her estate's or her family's? Just her? Seven strike of lightning, what do you think that means? It's not a golden ball. What the bloody hell is that supposed to mean? What? There is more than one here. Dante, are you alright? There is a second golden ball in this manor. No. This isn't at all what I... Come back, Kathy. Please. Hear my voice just this once, Kathy. I'm serious. Oh, Nelly, this room is haunted. I saw a ghost. Again with this, Kathy. What did I say? I told you I would thrash that evil ghost and hang them to dry on the rack. Nelly has not changed a bit. She doesn't age. Ghosts aren't real. She's such a big liar. I'm not lying. I'm sorry, children. Have you been waiting long?
Dad,
where's my violin? What about my X-Corp all-purpose wrench? Again, I'm sorry. I did not have room for the violin or the wrench. What room? What's that? What's that dirty rag? Ew. I found this child dying alone in the streets. He was without parents or a home. The boy would surely have died in a weather like this. So what? I don't want that gross, dirty kid living here. Yeah, I want my violin. Throw that thing out. What are you gawking at? Violin! I want my violin! Papa, why was he all alone in the streets? Because there wasn't anyone to take care of him. Poor child. There are other children like him in the back streets. No parents or relatives to look after them. No homes to shelter them. Then what does he have now? Well, Kathy, now he has got us to look after him. And this place as his home. No, I don't want that ugly thing. So you're saying that you don't want to have him, right? Oh, wind's howling, I can hear something wailing. Its cry is echoing through the manor halls. I hear it too, miss. Close the window, there's a nip in the air outside. Do you remember still? As a child, you were terribly afraid of these howling winds. That you're seeing ghosts. Nelly, I see them still. Miss, you've grown far too weak ever since Heathcliff departed the manor. That is why you are seeing things. That is all right, Nelly. I no longer fear the ghost. Because all fear stems from the ignorance of its origin. Where do you suppose he is, Heathcliff? Miss, he doesn't have anything left. I am everything he has. Riddles.
What is happening?
What just happened? Everything went dark for a second. I think the lightning caused a brief power outage. The power is back now, though. What we just saw were Catherine's memories, right? I think so. As though it has been in the... As... It has been in the past such occurrences can be attributed to the influence of the golden bow. Hold on, this is the corridor we walked through earlier, isn't it? This isn't where we were before the power outage. I don't see Henley or Linton anywhere either. Oh my, what just happened?
Well,
we didn't take like a step or anything, did we? I do not believe that any of our fellows have moved. If we were all standing still, then I suppose this means that it's the house that moved. Knowing anything about this, Nelly? I haven't the slightest idea. I have been away from this manor for many years myself. I seldom had any reason to return ever since Miss Catherine married Master Linton and left this place to live with him. Catherine the deceased, didn't somebody mention that she purchased this manor, Wuthering Heights? Yes, indeed, but she did not immediately move here after the purchase. Oh, now that you mention it, I see that some changes have been made into this manor since I was gone. Nelly was probably referring to the numerous exposed cables, holes, and cracks that seem to have been painted over. Had I been the chief butler of this manor, I would not have let such slovenliness slide. Maybe she was trying to make modifications to the manor. Why is there a trail of blood? Anyone else notice that? Is it normal for rich folks to just buy a whole manor and modify it to their liking? I'd say it's kind of like changing your hairstyle once in a while. Maintaining the exact same style of hair for too long gets pretty boring, you know? So that's how. Casual, all full-on house remodeling is like the rich folk. So that's how casual, a full-on house remodeling is like for the rich folks, I see. Heathcliff? I hardly know what to tell you. I do not know what words could possibly comfort you now. Well, you said about Miss Catherine's death, and how you didn't believe that she was truly dead. I gave that idea some thought, and I agree, to an extent. What? Heathcliff's pupils suddenly dilated. Even I haven't seen Miss Catherine's body. I was so beside myself when Master Linton told me of Miss Catherine's passing that I didn't even care to verify it with my own eyes. So what are you trying to say here is it really quick? I think it is? You're saying that Kathy might still be alive? Nothing but a suspicion at this point. Besides, you know how Miss Catherine can be. Stubborn as a mule, sometimes doing things so unexpected that they're almost frightening. Honestly, I even wonder if this whole funeral business was but an awful elaborate jest from the miss. What's certain is, however, that the will was undeniably in her own handwriting. And Master Linton, he never once stopped making modifications to the manor. Even after Miss Catherine passed. That bastard Linton made these modifications to the manor? Yes, I haven't gotten a good look at this place. Nor did I personally ask him for his motives, but it is quite evident that something is to transpire here, isn't it? Or that something has already happened. Bollocks, I don't understand any of this. What do you think the lightning in her will is talking about? Maybe she meant it literally. Seven lightning strikes. Are you suggesting that she knew that we would arrive precisely under this weather on the day of her funeral? Unless she moonlighted us as a renowned prophet, I don't see that happening. Unless she moonlighted as a renowned prophet, I don't see that happening. Who knows? I don't even understand what Miss Catherine was trying to do here with that will. Right, we can't ever know the will of the dead. Oh. Perhaps there is something, a clue, to be found in Miss Catherine's room? She did visit Wuthering Heights from time to time, even after her marriage to Mr. Linton. Don't you remember Heathcliff, Miss Catherine? Yeah, she always liked riddles. Not like you, who preferred a more direct approach, which involved smashing everything to pieces. Got me in plenty of trouble for trying to brute force problems without even trying to think about the intent. A faint smile appeared on Heathcliff's face as he seemed to recall a fond memory. I don't know if I've gotten any better at it since. But the heavy, somber expression soon returned. I guess our next order of things is to find where that room is?